C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
These killing children are out here killing children. My grandson's blood is on the streets of Baltimore City, and I will not rest until justice is done for Deontay Dorsey.
That is the grandmother of Deontay Dorsey, who was one of several students shot outside Edmondson High School. He was murdered. He was killed. We still do not have a suspect in custody in that case.
Nope.
Still weeks later, that's where we are.
Even with video.
Clearly there had to be somebody who knew something, but it just is so hard for people to come forward
to help
out police.
Four of the students wounded. And one of them was critical. One of the four students wounded was critical.
Congressman Kweisi Mfume joins us now on the C4 and Bryan Nehman Show. Congressman,
good
great
morning,
to have you on. We appreciate it. A lot of different things to get to, especially as it relates to crime. But I did want to start with that first kind of topic that we brought up, and that is trying to get people to come forward with information. You have sponsored a bill that may help in that aspect. Can you give us a little bit details about the Witness Security and Protection Act?
Absolutely, and good morning to both of you. Thank you for having me. This act of Congress would do one specific thing. It would protect witnesses. We always tell people, if you see something, say something. And then when oftentimes when they say something, they find themselves immersed in the stop snitching culture that has existed in Baltimore for the last 25 years. This really hit home to me many, many years ago when the Dawson family in East Baltimore came forward because the mother, Angela Dawson, saw drug dealing. She wanted to testify. The guy or guys who were involved later kicked in her door in the middle of the night, threw firebombs in, killed her, her husband, and all five of their children. And that really was the point in time where this stop snitching culture sort of took root. So I think we've got to protect witnesses. This bill creates a program in the Justice Department to do that. It funds it with $30 million a year for the next 5 years. It's for cities where this is particularly pervasive, and Baltimore obviously is at the top of that list.
Maryland Congressman Kweisi Mfume is on here, and the new Baltimore City State Attorney Ivan Bates was just interviewed the last couple of days, Congressman, saying how needed this is and how you would really, if this were to pass Congress, help him and other state attorneys across the country. But I do have to ask you, Congressman, with the murder of a 15-year-old just at this past Forest Park High School this past week, we are seeing too many of our children the victims of gun crime, and we've got to find a way, Congressman, to get to the heart of this.
I agree. I could not agree more. It's so pervasive. It's almost, as I've said many times, as if juveniles are starting to run the city, to dictate the pace and to eliminate, to the extent they can, any sense of normalcy. So, you know, people have kind of snickered when I've said over and over again, this has got to be the number one priority. You know, it's one thing to say it, but it's another thing to do it.
That's
and
right.
You have to do it through leadership and through example and through reward and punishment. But to just wait for another shooting and another one, you know, I'm like everybody else. I cannot believe that young people are dying at this rate, or people in general. 21 people have been killed this year, and we are still in January. Another 32 shot. Three Baltimore teens under the age of 17 killed, and before the day is over, that might be five under the age of 17. So I'm as best I can, trying to ring a bell for people who may not hear the bell or have not heard it, that this is not just on citizens. It's on all of us, particularly those of us in leadership. And I know the police department is challenged with low numbers in their ranks. I know that this stop snitching culture is everywhere. But if you shoot me and I live, I know who shot me, and I'm going to say something. But in many of these instances, people do not, and teenagers in particular, I'm sure, are scared to death to say anything if they survive.
Yeah. All right. So on your specific bill, this is just money that is allocated to the states or to cities, and they can use it the way however they want. I mean, how is the money used to protect people, I guess, is I'm kind of wondering.
Well, there has to be a real deliberate proposal laying out how the money would be used in your particular city or county or wherever it is. But it does give cities and states, but more importantly, community organizations and police departments, an opportunity to be able to put in place witness protection programs. You would think that they are already in place, but they're not. There are a few on the federal level, but you've got to be some major, major drug cartel dealer to be involved in that or to take advantage of it. These grants will be competitively given where qualified by the Department of Justice in conjunction with the FBI, but specifically to empower local police departments, local state's attorneys who really need to get these witnesses to court, and other organizations that are working in this area. So it's not a cash cow. It's not a giveaway. It's saying where you have a real problem protecting witnesses, particularly as in Baltimore, the Attorney General will distribute this money to you and to the programs that are in place to be able to move people if they have to be relocated, to provide additional security around their homes if they have to be protected in that sense, or any other way in that proposal for dollars that speaks to the ability of local police departments and others to protect people. And we can't just keep saying, if you see something, say something. We have an obligation to protect witnesses.
Maryland Congressman Kweisi Mfume is on board with us. He is Congressman of the 7th Congressional District. The majority of the district is Baltimore City, but also includes Howard County and parts of Baltimore County. Congressman, your legislation, the Witness Security and Protection Grant Program Act, has the endorsement of FOP, National Fraternal Police, National Center for Victims of Crime, and the National District Attorneys Association. And I wanted to mention all of that because it is getting a lot of support. I do have to ask you, Congressman, I know you got a lot on your plate and a lot of things that are busy, but before he passed away, Congressman Elijah Cummings went to Annapolis and prevailed upon legislators in Annapolis when somebody we know quite well, Delegate Talmadge Branch's grandson, was shot and killed. There was legislation they were trying to advance, and it was kind of stuck. And he went down there, and Congressman Cummings turned the tide in terms of getting them on board. There's a bill that State's Attorney Ivan Bates wants to get through that will simply help him when it comes to gun crimes. Is there any way that you or the members of the Congress could just get with State's Attorney Bates, prevail upon our legislators to try to get this one tool that is not lock them up, it's not mandatory members, it's just a tool that State's Attorney Bates needs, Congressman?
Well, State Attorney Bates and I have talked about this issue. I support him, and I'd like to think that he supports me and my efforts, and he mentioned that the other day. I have no problem testifying or in any form on this particular piece of legislation. As I understand it, it changes the definition of gun possession from a misdemeanor to a felony. It builds in some discretion that judges have 1 to 3 years. Is that correct?
Where they can up to five.
But 1 to 5 years.
But discretion is there. It's not mandatory.
And it's over 21 too.
It's not. It does not take discretion away from judges. I supported this last year, where this was a part of the former governor's package. So I'm on board. I've been on board. I don't know what's happening right now in Annapolis and why there seems to be a sort of slow rollout of this. But I know that 3 weeks of the session has already passed, which means there are only 9 weeks left to act, and shorter than that in terms of what you know, Clarence, to be the crossover period.
Yes.
If there is not swift action on this, we might see what we saw the last time, where it goes away. So I'll go anywhere. Including, fortunately, WBAL now to talk about my support of Ivan Bates and his efforts in this regard.
Well, it's good to hear. Because you said, you know, ring the bell. It's so frustrating because we feel like the bell is not being heard by certain people. I mean, we talk to tons of people on a regular basis, whether they're reverends, whether they're coaches, whether they're citizens, black and white, Republican and Democrat, and they're all like, this is a crisis that's going on, especially with juveniles. And then we hear from lawmakers in Annapolis, and, you know, we just had one yesterday that said there wasn't a crisis, that the numbers are actually going down. And it just defies logic to what we see on a regular basis. One of the first things that the Democrats did in the Senate, SB1, had to do with, you know, law-abiding citizens who want
right to
buy
carry.
Guns
yeah.
and get a permit to carry. It's not going against criminals. So what do you think is happening? Can you put your finger on it, on why there is resistance from Democrats, including the Baltimore delegation, even though we're having 330 people murdered every single year, or why they won't go after criminals and make things tougher on them?
Well, I don't know why. I mean, if I did... I could make a lot of money because a lot of people want to realize and understand what's behind the pace behind this. But I can tell you this, you know, just speaking, take me out of the role as a member of Congress, just as a member of the community. My heart breaks when I see this. My anger boils when I see it continue over and over again. I just want everybody to have that same sort of desire to end this. And nobody has the answer, but we've got to at least start trying things. And in the absence of that, we're just waiting around for another kid to get shot, another person to be murdered, another carjacking to take place. And I can't speak for members of the state legislature, nor would I, but I think before this session is over, which is, again, about 9 weeks away, it'll be an opportunity for everybody to be graded on their efforts on this. And I would love to believe that this is the year that this bill gets through.
Another thing I wanted to mention, Congressman, before we let you go, besides the Witness Security and Protection Grant Program, you also have legislation identifying mass shooters called the Identifying Mass Shooters Act. Could you just tell us a little bit about what this is and why you felt compelled to introduce this?
I can, and I forgive me, I should have also mentioned the fact that Senator Ben Cardin is a co-lead on the Witness Protection Act. We
yes.
are doing this together with a bill both in the Senate and the House in an effort to kind of get it through as quickly as we can. The other piece of legislation is the Identifying Mass Shooters Bill. And what this act of Congress does is says to the Justice Department that they are to aggregate the data that they already have, the digital data, on all of the mass shooters over the last 20 years. All of that information is on file. It's at the Justice Department. It's in the FBI. And right now, I think it's only being used to sort of put together a profile. What this bill does is to try to put together a probability by looking at all of those digital footprints, all of the information we have in terms of their linguistic boastings online, all of a person's visits to the dark web and the things that are being said and trafficked on the dark web. It also looks at other postings and clicks that are part of a process that, when aggregated together, says, yeah, this might be a profile, but over here is the probability that this person is about ready to do something. It's another tool, I think, for law enforcement. If, in fact, and this is not violating rights of anybody, it's very constitutional, it does not create a great deal of surveillance if you're living right. But if you're doing all these things and it's aggregated to suggest that you have a digital footprint that suggests that you are about to do something, it gives law enforcement the ability, if they were already considering and worrying about person A, to be able to harden targets that person has talked about. So some people talk about they hate their job, they don't like the school in their neighborhood because they don't like kids. There are other things that relate to domestic situations. If we're able to have that and are able in advance to harden our targets, like the school in Uvalde,
mm-hmm.
Or the shopping center in Boston, or the nightclub, the dance club in California, where these things have previously existed in terms of their own linguistics and their boastings online and the places they've searched. They want to buy bullets. They want to talk about how to assemble an AK-47. They make statements that scientifically we ought to look at. And I think mm-hmm. science, to a large extent, has to be a part of trying to figure out how we find them before they find us.
This is fascinating, but you know it's going to be controversial. When you say it allows police or the FBI to harden the targets, does it also mean that you can knock on this person's door and maybe even arrest them beforehand?
No. You really can't do something until somebody does something. This
right.
just gives you an idea in terms of probabilities.
Like radar. Gives you radar on them.
Right. It's like if somebody's outside of your house and they've got a gun in their hand and they're saying, I'm going to rob you when you come out. They're crying out for some kind of attention. We don't ignore that. We're going to call the police. Well, on the internet, and particularly the dark web, these persons feel free to say what they don't like, what they do like, what they want to do, who they want to hurt. And, you know, I don't believe we ought to ignore any of that. I think we ought to aggregate it scientifically through computer science and come up with models of probability that say this, in fact, is a person that is much more likely to do something like this. This is what they rant and rave against, and this is an ability to take a soft target and make it harder so that if, in fact, they do something, we don't have the same loss of life.
Well, Maryland Congressman Kweisi Mfume, we always appreciate your time. We do have the state's attorney, Evan Bates, coming on Monday, and I think, once again, he'll be glad to kind of hear, I know he's heard it already privately, but publicly, your support that you shared this morning. Thank you so much.
Great to have you on, as always.
Thank you both. I appreciate it.